Hello everyone and welcome to Australian Survivor Week 3 Power Rankings and Recap. As you can see, I changed the mug this week to my Disneyland Paris mug, and that will all make sense in about 30 seconds. Look, I'm going to start this recap with a question, and that is, name a more depressing romance than Sam and Mark on Australian Survivor. I'll wait. Romeo and Juliet who? The Notebook who? Stuart Little 3 Call of the Wild who? So as you know, on Sunday night, Sam left, and then on Monday night, Mark left. And if you didn't know that and you're watching a Week 3 recap video, first of all, what are you doing? Second of all, I've already got your view, so you can click out if you really need to. So with Sunday and Monday's episodes, I was both very right and very wrong. So at the last rankings that I did last week, I said that Sam was at the bottom, she was going to get kicked on the Sunday, and I got that right. But then I also put Mark as my number one. So I got new rules, I got them. So yeah, I had Mark at the top of my list because my reasoning last week was that Mark is too much of a physical asset for them to kick out. Obviously, I was wrong. Queen Jackie and Henry executed that shit well, got rid of Mark. First of all, I was semi-shook. I was going to say shook beyond belief, but I wasn't shook beyond belief because I believed it. But when Jackie was on that, she was on that chopping block. She was with those onions. She was with that tuna. She was with that raw chicken on that chopping board. She was ready to get chopped, C-H-O-P-P apostrophe D. And Henry was not flashing that idol. Did you see that? Jackie was like, you gonna give me that idol, boy? And then Henry's like, nah, Jackie. Nah, if you go, that's it. Ciao for now. But she didn't go, so I kind of want to see a little bit of, like, sass and fire there, but I don't really think that's going to happen, judging from the commercials for next week. So obviously I like to talk about Queen Jackie because she's the best thing to grace Australian TV in the last 10 years. But besides that, this week, there was that whole, like, I feel like if I had to describe these episodes in two words, it would be power couple. Because on Sunday night, that's why Sam went home. Henry and Jackie were like, hold on. Back it up, put it down, flip it and reverse it. Let's get rid of Sam because Mark and Sam are too strong together. So they got rid of Sam and then Mark went on the revenge warpath SAS skills. And he ended up getting kicked as well because they were like, you need to chill out, mate. You need to chill out. If you turned on Channel 10 anytime between 9 o'clock on Sunday to 7:30 on Monday, you would have seen the ads for Henry versus Mark. So they were going for that whole revenge storyline. I'm just like, ugh, you could so tell what was going to happen. It's like one of them's going to go and it's not going to be Henry because he has an idol anyway. So it was going to be Mark. He just knew it was going to be Mark going. But they tried to like spice it up by chucking in Jackie's name. I got really stressed out when Mark was like, we need to go for Jackie. And I was like, hold the fuck up. Go for Henry. Why are you going for Jackie? Jackie's my queen. But oh my god, guys, I made a major like breakthrough on Monday. This is a mush quality, by the way. Mark literally looks like Wreck-It Ralph. Like, have you seen Wreck-It Ralph before? Why is that big ass jawline reminding me of something or someone? And then it clicked. I was like, he's literally Wreck-It Ralph. I mean, this is Wreck-It Ralph and this is Mark from Survivor. Tell me I'm wrong, because I'm not. Ralph decides to take matters into his own hands. He sets off on a game-hopping trip to prove he has what it takes to be a hero. However, while on his quest, Ralph accidentally unleashes a deadly enemy that threatens the entire arcade. The arcade is a saga. The deadly enemy is Henry. So after I realized that Wreck-It Ralph is literally Mark, I was like, I wonder if I can put all the other people into a Disney show. And I did a little research. And I found out that a saga is literally Lilo and Stitch and Sam and Tao is literally Kim Possible. So let me get stuck into these rankings and let me reveal to you the biggest conspiracy of 2017. Let's go ahead and start the power rankings with a saga, the saga and a saga this week. And number 9, I have Myrtle, also known as Michelle, also known as The Nanny, also known as The Nanny. I feel like the sentence in Myrtle's bio on Wikipedia that really cemented the fact that Michelle is Myrtle is it says, Myrtle plays a key role in Lilo and Stitch 2, Stitch Has a Glitch, classic movie by the way, as one of the entrants in the hula contest that is central in the film's plot. That's literally Michelle on the island. If there was a hula contest, she would be central in that plot. But backing away from my batshit crazy analogy for about 20 seconds, talk about why Michelle's on the bottom. I feel like, so with my rankings last week, Sam was on the bottom because there was clearly something going to happen there. It was pretty obvious that one of the two, Sam or Mark, was going to get kicked. I thought it was going to be Sam, and Sam went first. This week, Henry and Jackie have got rid of that threat. So now they're kind of like, maybe we should make the tribe stronger. So that's why I'm saying Michelle at the bottom. I definitely think it's worth mentioning that the ads for this Sunday's episode are extra beyond belief. They're like supersized Big Mac extra. They are this oversized Disneyland Paris mug with water extra. So in the sneak peek, it says Lockie won't see it coming. Henry and Ziggy won't see it coming. Something, 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 tribal bombshell. And then I was like, hold on. Why would they say Lockie, Henry, and Ziggy when Henry and Ziggy are on opposite tribes? That made me think it might be a tribe swap. I don't think I want a tribe swap because that's what fucked up Phoebe's game last year. Phoebe was killing that shit, and then all of a sudden we had Sue moving around. We had Brooke coming over taking Sue. Ooh. So number 8, I have Pleakley, also known as Ben. Look at them. Do they not look like the same person? Just put the image of Pleakley with his wig on and then look at Ben. They are the same person.
His body shape and style of movement resembles the enchanted brooms from the Sorcerer's Apprentice sequence in Fantasia. Stop! This is too accurate!
In terms of the actual show this week, Ben got a confessional. I'm shook. I heard him speak. I thought, okay, this is a deeper voice than what I expected. You're speaking slower than I expected, but I can work with this. I think he had at least two confessionals, but the one that I can remember at the moment is the one where he's talking about Luke and he's like, he has an issue with authority and it's going to come back to bite him sooner rather than later. And I thought, Ben, that's very insightful of you. Next, I have Jumba, also known as Kent. He has been called an idiot scientist, but he prefers to be known as an evil genius and is in fact surprisingly sociable and friendly outside of his work. That's kind of relevant because Kent is just annoying me. Kent, oh my god, why is Kent still here? Like, I would rather have Sam than have Kent. I would rather have Mark promoting his leather jackets on my TV screen than Kent. When he was in the ocean doing like fucking handstands with Jackie, Queen Jackie's doing these handstands that looking, she's killing it. I would give it a 10 out of 10 if I was on the Olympic committee. And then Kent does it. I'm like, stop. I would rather watch Hell's Kitchen than watch Kent do backflips and handstands in the ocean, and that's saying something because Hell's Kitchen is terrible. Knowing my luck, you know what's gonna happen? Kent will probably win. He'll probably fucking pull out some shit idol, I don't know, worm his way through to the merge and then get through to the end. He'll probably win now that I'm thinking about it. No, I want him gone. Okay, number 6, I have Luke. And Luke kind of started this Lilo and Stitch analogy because he's literally experiment 625. Reuben has every ability Stitch has, but he prefers to make sandwiches than use his powers. Don't get me wrong, I love a good blindside, but I feel like Luke is kind of doing too much now. I'm the boss. What does this mean? What does that mean? And is that some kind of code that I don't understand? Like, what is this? I'm the boss. So Luke's all like, I'm the boss. I'm gonna flip this vote. I'm gonna vote out Jackie now. I'm gonna vote out Sam. Like, okay, calm down. But I don't think they would get rid of Luke just yet because they got rid of Mark and Mark was a challenge strength. Okay, so my number 5 is the Grand Councilwoman. If you look at this picture, who in a saga do you think that this person is? If you don't say that it's Jackie, you are lying. It's literally Jackie. Listen to this. It seems that the Grand Councilwoman has a status as a supreme leader of the Galactic Federation, similar to an empress in an empire, Queen Jackie. Queen Jackie, Grand Councilwoman. Did you catch her Monopoly analogy on Sunday night? Like, I think that's the most important thing to happen to me in my life. I mean, I've graduated from my undergraduate degree and I'm doing a postgraduate degree, but that's nothing compared to this analogy that Jackie whipped out on Sunday. It just made my life. It was something along the lines of, you're playing Monopoly with your friend, but that doesn't mean that if you get on Mayfair, you're not going to populate that shit with hotels and run them into the ground. And then on Monday night, I got shitty with Mark because... Oh, I said that so proper. Shitty. I got proper shitty with Mark because he was targeting Jackie. Like, back off. Get off the Grand Council, woman. You are Wreck-It Ralph. You're in the wrong universe. Stay in your domain. And that's how Sue sees it. Cool. All right. Number four. I have Stitch. Jericho. So Jericho is Stitch mainly because of this sentence. He has a short temperature. He has a short temperature. Fucking, I need to sleep. He has a short temper and mischievous behavior. I feel like that's accurate because remember all the cookie drama, that's quite mischievous. Short temper, that's a reach, but we can make it work. I'm trying to think why anyone would vote out Jericho. The only reasons I can think of is to make Luke weaker, but at the same time, you would just vote out Luke. You wouldn't vote out Jericho. Whereas with Henry and Jackie, you would vote out Jackie because you need Henry in the challenges. If you wanted to get rid of Luke, you would just get rid of him because Jericho is pretty much as good as him in challenges. My number three is Gantu, also known as Henry. Gantu is a respected captain of the Galactic Federation, brackets, or at least he used to be. He can dance the hula, brackets, as seen in the episode clip. Well, I don't know why I said that out loud. It's literally as irrelevant as you can get. And he does have many skills. He lost a wrestling match to an old lady, Sugar Mama from the Proud Family. When did that happen? Did I miss that? I need to rewatch this now. He might have a smooth ride until the merge, but I didn't put him as 201 for a reason. And that's because I feel like he's putting a target on his own back. By making these moves, getting rid of Sam, getting rid of Mark, he's putting himself as the main strategic person in a saga, and that's not necessarily a great thing. It's good for us as viewers, but for him as a player, it puts a target on his back saying, I'm a threat, get rid of me. But on the flip side of that, as I said before, they can't really get rid of him now because then they won't have any, like, brawn in the challenges because they got rid of Mark. Number two, I have Lilo, which is obviously Odette. And can we take a second to appreciate that Odette actually had a confessional this week? She actually had screen time this week. And then in the Tribal Council, she had this whole sentence about something and everyone was like giving like dramatic looks to her, like boom, boom. Look, Odette is not going anywhere this week because if they're getting rid of weak people, they're getting rid of Michelle, they're getting rid of Ben, they're getting rid of Kent. If they're getting rid of strategic threats, they're getting rid of Henry, they're getting rid of Jackie. They are not getting rid of Odette. She is not going anywhere. So Odette is in a fantastic position, but not as a good a position as my number one, who is Sarah, who is Nanny from Lilo and Stitch. Why did I say it like that? Her worst fear is noted to be losing Lilo to social workers like Cobra Bubbles, whom she at first disliked, but after the events of the first film comes to trust and respect. Maybe I didn't do this one properly. But guys, let's lay out these facts right now. Like, let's lay all our cards on the table. Sarah is not going anywhere except the merge. Why would you vote out Sarah? If you're Henry and Jackie, you need that number. And if you're Luke trying to start something, you also need that number because she is in a massive position of power. Same as Odette. They have that swing vote at the moment. So in terms of power rankings to make it through the next week, Sarah is my number one because she is not going anywhere. Alrighty, that's a saga for this week. Let's go to Samatow, who managed to stay out of both tribal councils this week. For this tribe, I've decided to go down the route of Kim Possible, another iconic series from the 2000s. And to best talk about the rankings, I have to reveal the first three altogether. So my 8, 7, and 6 are Shigo, Migo, and Higo, also known as the Go Team, also known as Tara, Annalise, and Lockie. Number 8, Tara. Tara broke the fuck down on Sunday. Tara needs to hit reboot. She needs to reset her calculator. She needs to redo those sums and realize that breaking down is not going to help anyone. Had the waterworks going and I was like, okay, this is some elaborate ploy to get people to feel sorry for her and eventually flip everyone on AK and vote him out. No, she was just crying. So I know that it's obviously a very stressful situation. And I know that she was in a position of power and then literally won tribal council and she got shat on after that. In terms of power rankings, Tara is 8 because they're not voting out Lockie yet. And between her and Annalise, I think AK would see Tara as more of a threat. And that's why the Alliance would vote for Tara. That's just my vibe. But, mind you, Ziggy got airtime in the last episodes by talking to Tara and Lockie about voting AK out. So that could be something that happens, because Ziggy wasn't getting airtime before, and then all of a sudden she's getting airtime about a move that could possibly happen, and it would be a huge move. Number 7, I have Annalise, Queen of Lies. Annalise, Queen of Misleading the Tribe. On Sunday night when they won the reward challenge, and AK like planted the seed that there would be a clue somewhere in the barbecue. That rhymed, that was nice. So Annalise was obviously, very obviously looking for a clue in the esky, and then someone asked her about it and she was like, oh, I'm just looking for ice to put in the cups. Queen of Lies. Yeah, look, I don't have much to say about Annalise, except that she's not in a great position. She's in the minority. I wouldn't say she's in as bad a position as Tara, but I would also say she's not in as good a position as Lockie. That's it. Number 6, I have Higo, which is Lockie. Only reason why they would keep Lockie around is for challenges. He consistently does well in challenges. They would do well not to get rid of him, but I didn't put him higher just because his alliance of 3 is quite far down at the moment. They are trying to spin some shit with Ziggy. They'll probably try and get Peter back. But to be honest, I don't think it's going to work. But I guess we'll just have to see what happens. So number 5, I have Kim Possible, also known as Tessa. Tessa is literally Kim Possible, because it's Kim Possible that she's made it this far. Just think about that transformation. She was on the bottom. She was about to get booted. And she's made it. She's made it to the top, what is that, 17? So she's made it through 7 eliminations. And she just has to make it to 5 more. And then they'll be at the merge. So she just has to make it through. And I think she can. I think she has what it takes to make it to the merge. And if Tessa makes it to the merge, I feel like a world of opportunities will open up for her. Number 4, I have Wade, aka AK. Wow. AK, as usual, getting a lot of narrating time. I'm buying what he's selling. I know a lot of people can't stand him. But I like that he's playing the game. He seems to have toned it down a little bit now, but that also might just be because they're not going to Tribal Council. I want Sam and Tao to go to Tribal Council because they always have some extra shit happening. So I feel like that would be really fun to watch. And I feel like that's something that could happen on Sunday, especially with their whole tribal bombshell thing that they're advertising. I'm kind of shook because I'm like, how is that going to impact how these people playing their games? I want to see how AK is impacted by the tribal bombshell. Number 3, I have Ronstoppable, which is Peter. Peter is rising through these ranks. As I said last week, I'm a Peter stan. I think Peter is in a position of power. I think my top 3 are all in positions of power, mainly because of their ability to swing between alliances if they choose to. Think about it. If AK and Tessa want to keep knocking out Tara, Annalise, and Lockie, they need Peter's vote. If Annalise, Lockie, and Tara want to vote for AK, they need Peter's vote. So it's kind of like he can do whatever he wants, and he will definitely make it through the next tribal council and maybe the next 2. He's consistently getting airtime now, which is good. It's kind of cementing him as a strategic player, which I like. And that's good for him because I'm getting major merge vibes. So number 2, I have Rufus. And Rufus is Jared. But don't think for a second that I'm being shady by saying that, because listen to this sentence from Rufus's Wikipedia page. Rufus goes on nearly all missions and, because of his small size, often proves useful. Is that not Jared? Bear with me for a second. In a stitch in time, a version of Rufus from the future named Rufus 3000 visits Kim, asking her to help in saving the future from Shigo. Let's decode that. In a stitch in time, a version of Jared from the future named Jared post-merge visits Tessa, asking her to help in saving the future from Tara. Jared's making it to the merge. In terms of edit, I mean, Sam and Tao as a whole obviously had less screen time this week because Asaga went to Tribal Council both nights. But out of Sam and Tao, I still think that Jared's getting one of the most, if not the most, positive edit, which is a good sign because it's almost definite merge vibes and potential to go very far. So my number 1, just quickly, I'm loving that I can put this person at number 1. My number 1 is Ziggy, also known as Bonnie Rockwaller from Kim Possible. Yes, I know Bonnie is like an antagonist in Kim Possible, but they kind of look alike. All right, leave me alone. Look, I straightened my sitting position because I'm excited to say Ziggy got significant airtime this week. You might think, oh, she only had a few confessionals. But think about those confessionals in the context of the entire edit. So they obviously focused on a saga. Samatau wasn't getting airtime, but when they did get airtime, quite a bit of it was going to Ziggy, which is fantastic for Ziggy because she is a powerful swing vote, which they showed it through her confessionals. So we saw a scene of Tara, Lockie and Ziggy on the beach with Tara and Lockie trying to convince Ziggy to vote with them to vote out AK. Then we also know that she voted with AK, Jared and Peter and Tessa to vote out Amy in the last tribal council. So she is in a perfect position to make it through the next two episodes, because why would you vote for Ziggy? If you're AK and you're, if you're Tessa, if you're Peter, if you're Jared, you're going for Tara, you're going for Annalise, you're going for Lockie. You're not going for Ziggy yet. I think Ziggy's almost definitely in the merge. I feel like she's getting a very good edit. Wouldn't be surprised if she goes far. Same thing I said with Jared.
Yeah, cool. I'm wearing a different outfit now and get used to it. It's a different day. It's a different time. Jake's ready to do his rankings tonight, so I'm video calling. And I'm also wearing pajamas on the bottom. But because you can only see from here up, it really doesn't matter.
All right. What's good, everyone? My computer has absolutely... I don't even know what's happening. Remember the virus where I couldn't go on any website except Facebook?
Do you remember that virus where you spilled water on your computer?
Huge change up from last week by me.
Will I be shook? Jackie's...
Like, you're going to be shook because if you remember last week, I had Jericho at number 2 and we're going to kick it off with number 9, Jericho.
You wouldn't.
There seems to be, like, Jackie just seems like someone that is going to, she's going to take these 3 votes personally. She's going to find out who it is, and she's going to make it her mission for them to go. Yeah. All right, so number 9, Jericho, just because in trouble with Jaquid.
Okay.
Number 8, Kent, because, well, he's still fat and slow. Number 7, Ben, because he still doesn't talk.
He got airtime.
And then his voice is, like, 7 octaves lower than what I thought.
I was shook, and like his eyebrows were way thick than I remember.
Like now I can understand why he hasn't, why they haven't been showing him speaking. But still not sure where he is, so keeping him at 7.
Fair.
Number 6, I've got Luke.
Same.
I don't actually think he's in that much trouble. I think he'll be able to get himself out of this situation, and I still think he can divert some of that attention to Kent and Ben and people that are going to keep letting him down in challenges.
Right.
But I feel like if it was a Ben versus Luke showdown,
yeah.
I feel like Luke would win, surely. Cool. Number 5, I have Michelle, because she's another one where it's like, I'm just not sure where she's at. She was the target at the vote where Samantha left, because they said she was weak, and you know that's never really a position you want to be in. But she seems really cool, really friendly,
yeah.
And she seems everyone. She's been in the majority with every vote. And it's going to be interesting to see where she goes. She's had a bit of airtime, you know.
She has, hasn't she?
Survived a couple of votes. It's going to be fun to see where she goes from here. Number 4, I've got Odette, because we heard her speak, and she was amazing. She's everything. I'm obsessed with Odette after hearing her voice. Like, I just thought she would have an accent, and she didn't. And then, like, her strong Aussie accent, and I was like, oh, for Odette. But I just get this, she ain't taking no bullshit kind of vibe.
I agree. She's like, I feel like her and Sarah have similarities in terms of where they are in the alliances.
Number 3, I've got Sarah.
Okay.
A good couple of episodes for Sarah. She played it really cool. She, you know, there was no way she was going along with Luke's plan, and her way to make sure she didn't have to keep lying was, this is the last conversation we're having about it, we don't want to be seen, like, this is it, done. But she was never, ever voting with her, and she went up to Henry and Jackie just said, whatever you hear, I'm voting with you. Like, I just love that, like, style of gameplay. Like, you know she's loyal to them. She's just shutting it down. But then they kind of kept it in confusion of where she's really at. But there was no voting with Luke and Jericho. She'd be all these conversations nonstop and just telling people what they want to hear. And that's perfect.
Major merge vibes?
Yeah, if she can keep doing that and not getting called out, I could see Sarah going so far into this.
Yeah.
And I hope she does.
Agreed.
Number 2. Well, they've been calling them the power couple, and I've got them at 2 and 1.
But what order?
But I've got Henry at 2 and Jaquie at 1.
Oh, Jaquie.
I'm keeping Jaquie at 1. She's my winner's pick. She seemed like she was in trouble there, but she has just shown that when her name's going to come up, she is going to be ready to fight. Mark is a fucking, like, special ops person, and she had him shook. She had him so shook at tribal. She was having none of that.
Can we quickly appreciate her Monopoly analogy? How amazing was that? How, like, off the cuff as well?
I had one problem with it, though.
What?
Book hotels on Mayfair, you also have to own the $350 one, which you did not reference.
Park Lane?
Summer Town, the Jared Tribe. Correct. Okay. Number 8. Who is she? Who is she? It's Annalise.
I had her at 7.
Annalise, she was really good at the challenge. She won that. She beat Sarah. Was it Annalise that beat Sarah twice? Yeah.
Yeah.
So she actually won it for her tribe. So, you know, she's shown that she could be strong. I mean, she beat a 50-kilo girl. but still, she's on the wrong side of the numbers, and she's probably... I mean, if you had to choose out of Tara, Annalise, and Lockie for who's going to let you down in the challenges, you'd probably be looking at...
You pick Tara. I feel like you just set yourself up for failure with that sentence.
But we're going to move on to number 7.
Yes.
Queen of Flipping, Peter.
Oh.
So the thing with Peter is, I thought that, you know, the way he would do it, he'd go up to Tara and be like, it's just a game, she had to go, blah, blah, blah. But he's really just, I don't know, he's kind of isolated himself now from the Tara, Annalise, and Lockie threesome.
But does that matter?
But then at the same time, if it comes down to it, the people that he's with, he was the last person to join that alliance. He was never with them. So it's not looking good, I don't think, for him on either side. Number 6, I have Tara, who had the most ridiculous breakdown ever this week.
You're on Survivor. Queen of Tears, okay. Fair.
Queen of Tears, because, I'm sorry, but you're on Survivor.
Mm-hmm.
Chill the fuck out and change your own luck.
When she whipped out that finger and she was doing this across the tribe, I was like, Tara! What did she say?
Stuck to her word or something like that. And I was like, oh, she's great. She's great. I fucking love her. But that breakdown was so freaking. And, you know, she's a target. She's a big target if they lose. My number 5 is Huda Zrgwa.
I don't know if you can say Huda for her anymore.
Because she am a queen of having your first confessional in episode 7.
Queen of Ep 7 edit. And also, like, she's in the promos now.
It's so funny how her confessional was like, the way I want to play Survivor, which, like, for everyone else, we heard that in, like, episode 1 and 2. Then the outcome, I want to play Survivor like this. Well, it's like, well, you're only 20 days into it or something, so it's a good time. Number 4, I've got Tessa, Queen of the Underdogs.
Okay, fair.
Has got herself into a real good position. I don't think anyone even mentioned her name when they started talking about who to vote out. AK still has that target as, like, the big threat. And then, obviously, there's that whole minority alliance. So I reckon there's a plethora of people waiting to go before her. Number 3, his move, he is queen of, you know, having a tribe named after you.
Oh. Jared. Okay, yes.
Look, he's playing a great game. He didn't get, like, barely any airtime. How good did he do in that challenge? He did us, you know, severely underweight people proud. Like, he...
I was like, when Mark was, like, smashing him in the face, I was like, okay, you need to calm down. Like, you're going to win this either way. And he's, like, smashing the shit to Jared's face.
When he was under him and kind of, like, stood up, I was like, he's going to fucking win. And, like, the music and stuff, I was like, oh, my God. And then he was thrown off. But still. But then everyone, well, I think it was AK tweet, and was like, you did even better than the edit made it look or something like that. Yeah. So.
And also, like, all I could think of was how... like, dirty his hair would get, and what a mess that would be.
I was thinking that the whole time. I, like, I can't fathom going into Survivor with hair that long and luscious. It's not just long, it's, like, really, really nice hair, so he must have been viewing, to use Amy's words, after that challenge.
I wonder if he got that head and shoulders while on the beach.
Number 2, he's down 1 from last week. I've still got Lockie towards the top. I'm just sticking by physical threat, airtime. I feel like he's not the psycho, so out of Annalise, Tara, and him, he'll be the last one
to get. Yeah, okay.
So, time's on his side, you know, just having two people that would probably leave before him gives him time to make it to the verge where, and then anything could happen, you know what I mean? He will be safe for a while and then find himself in a power position again. Like, I'm not ruling him out at all. Number 1 is my nemesis, the bane of my existence, AK.
What are your reasons? Why is he your number 1 now and he wasn't last week?
Because last week, I just, like, he got all those votes at Tribal. He still had people coming after him. and I still just, I don't know, it's, well, I just go off my vibe. I just go off my vibe. And my vibe last week was that he was still in danger and they could all, like, that whole, remember how they originally started the alliance? Tessa and AK were out. And I just thought the way for them to all say, let's come back together, would be to for them to let's get rid of AK. But now I think Tara's tantrums have made sure that's not happening. That's, it's
and
kind
Emily's
of
Queen of Lies, yeah.
And he's safe. And then the fact that he's definitely safe for now and has played the best game out of the people in the majority, I thought it was time to hit him up to number one. But Soz, AK, I still hate you and I want your show sold. So looking forward to the next couple of episodes of Survivor. You know, the ratings are doing really well, so it won't be cancelled. But hopefully this week, the AK show gets cancelled.
So that brings me to the end of my Australian Survivor Week 3 recap and power rankings. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, leave a like. Much appreciated. Let me know in the comments if you disagree with what I say, if you agree with what I'm saying. Let me know who you think is confirmed for the merge based off the edit or what you're thinking. And if you're not subscribed already, make sure you subscribe. We're so close to 400. So close. And that's super exciting. And yeah, thanks for watching and I will see you soon. Bye.